Declassified, an ongoing webinar series brought to you by the Thurston County Chamber and the Thurston Economic Development Council. The purpose of the series is to provide timely information to assist business and community through the COVID-19 crisis. I'm David Schaffert, President and CEO of the Thurston County Chamber, along with Michael Cade, Executive Director of the Thurston EDC. It is a pleasure to have you joining us today. Today, we'll be having a conversation with the City of Olympia Mayor Cheryl Selby and City of Lacey Mayor Andy Ryder, and the role of local governments have in playing in dealing with our COVID crisis and the role that they will be playing in the future, especially as it relates to the restarting of our local economy. The second part of the program, we'll have an update from Employment Security Departments, Mary Pat, Kevin, and Denise, and we will look forward to the most recent information both from the federal standpoint and also how the state is dealing with the influx of requests. Before we get going though, with those conversations, just a reminder for everyone to go to thurstonstrong.org for up-to-date information. If there's things you want to know about, there's a whole bunch of information there about COVID, about business and employees and employers. It's really a wealth of information and is updated daily. As always, please feel free to ask questions during the conversation by the Zoom question tool, and we will work to incorporate those questions into the discussion. With that, let's get started. Thank you, Mayor Ryder and Selby, for taking the time to be here today. Why don't we start with the role your jurisdictions are playing during COVID crisis, and of course, anything that's on your mind that you'd like to share, and we'll move from that point forward. Thank you.
Did you want me to lead off?
Let's give you instructions. Let's start with Mayor Ryder, and then we'll have you chime in.
Okay.
Well, thank you. Obviously, this has been a very stressful time for anyone who is an elected official, let alone being the mayor. You know, this COVID-19, having a pandemic that is shut down our communities is not something that I woke up, you know, a couple months ago ever sort of predicting this could happen. And so it has been quite the shock to the whole community, and especially to a lot of our small business owners who I've really been focusing on as a small business owner myself, how difficult of a time this has been. And so the City of Lacey has really tried to address, you know, people's concerns from the very beginning. You know, we're can act as a sort of a the ability to collect information and know that it's a trusted source. And that is what's been somewhat difficult during this time, is there, especially early on, there was a lot of rumors and people are looking for accurate information. And so your local government is the government that, of course, has the most trust with the people. That's the way it's always been. We've always been closest to the people. And so we got in early and tried to, you know, give out as much accurate information and resources that we could. And of course, one of the things that we did from the get-go, and with the help of the EDC, is we started our small business grant program, which has been a tremendously successful. And I really want to thank the EDC for doing a lot of the heavy lifting, going through all the applications and verifying the applications and administering that program. It's been very successful, and we've had so many people reach out and who were really at the end of their financial capabilities, and they did not know what they were going to do. And luckily, they were able to have this resource from our community. So, you know, that is a lot of what we're doing in Lacey. Of course, you know, we get a lot of questions on can and cannot do. You know, people are wondering when we're going to get back open, and they have specific questions about that. Of course, we're also trying to, you know, give out good, solid information on other resources available in our community. And that has been a lot of what we're doing. Of course, this is another example of a lot of what I'm doing lately is we're on webinars all the time. You know, the city hall is closed. It's open by appointment if you are in need of a permit that qualifies. But it's eerie going to city hall right now and the public not being present. So that has been a big change, not only for myself, but of course all the Lacey staff trying to work from home and trying to continue to provide services to the people of Lacey in this new capacity.
Mayor Selby, why don't you chime on in?
All right. Hello, everybody out there in virtual land. I'm Cheryl Selby, and as Andy mentioned, I just ran for re-election, and never in my wildest nightmares had I envisioned that I'm probably going to be spending my whole term managing a crisis and seeing a community to recovery. But as we, you know, embark on our fifth week now of a state of emergency, I really also want to acknowledge everyone's shared sacrifice. I want to thank everybody for showing grit and resiliency as we're grappling with one of the most significant public health threats in a century. Everyone's economic and personal sacrifices have been so intense. And as a former business owner, my heart goes out to all of my my buddies downtown and on the west side that are struggling to figure out how they're going to reopen their doors and if they can. Then you add on top of that in this unique situation of social distancing. And so you have to do this alone, or it can feel very, very alone. So, you know, I wish I could answer the most common question we're all getting, which is, you know, when can we turn the switch back on? But, you know, like Andy said, you know, all of our crystal balls have been shattered, so we can't see into the future at this point. And the whole idea of how and when to reopen is like a delicate dance right now. And I listen every morning to Mayor Cuomo speak to the state of New York, and I've learned a lot from him. He's very matter of fact about things. He always says, you know, you need to lead with brutal honesty every day, but you also need to balance it with credible hope, because we have to inspire people to do harder things than they've ever had to do before. And local government is the closest access people have. And so we get a brunt of it, but we also have the huge privilege of being able to meet with our constituents virtually at this point, but we'll be able to be working hand in hand with our constituents as we move towards, you know, this response to, I'm gonna get this from a conversation I have with Mike Reed and Jason Robertson recently about the four phases. And right now we're in response. Soon we'll be looking to reopening and then recovery, and then the big planning around resiliency. So what are we learning from this difficult time that'll make us more resilient as new crises arrive?
Why don't the both of you maybe share about your thoughts on the coordinated response? So, you know, as a community, we always pride ourselves on, you know, waste treatment, public transit, emergency 911 communication. We all create these joint infrastructures. I would absolutely think in your minds right now that is where your mind is going on how we as a community versus individual jurisdictions pull together so we can leverage each other. What, you want to share some thoughts on that?
Sure. I'll get started and then you can chip in, Cheryl.
Sure.
So the three urban cities of Thurston County, the three Lacey, Olympia, and Tumwater, we have been meeting you know, with the county on occasion, but the three cities have been meeting every month, or at least every other month for quite a while.
Now we're doing weekly, we're doing Fridays.
Exactly, and so had already laid the foundation of communication between the three cities. There has never been this amount of coordination that has happened before. We are very lucky to have great relationships and great working relationships and friendships across all the jurisdictions. And then when COVID happened, we immediately brought in the county and agreed that we had to have weekly meetings about what's going on in our jurisdictions, and so we can have a coordinated response. Because the average person doesn't know when they're in Lacey, Olympia. I mean, our boundaries are kind of all over
the place. We have permeable borders.
Very, very. And so I think that has prepared us and has put us in a position to be more responsive than we've been before. And to be able to sort of speak with one voice, again, it's really important that the messaging coming from all the jurisdictions is similar at least, because you don't want, you know, Olympia doing something completely drastic, you know, from Tumwater and Lacey doing something else. You know, what you want is good information that's reliable, that is verifiable, and that everyone's on board with. And so we've already begun, you know, having conversations with looking at the additional funding that's coming to our region through the Community Development Block Grant, and seeing what we can do to hopefully coordinate, you know, with the cities and the county on a plan for those funds. And so that's just one of the examples of what we're doing, you know, working together on the behalf of the entire region.
And a great example is this very podcast. You know, one of the first things that, you know, Andy and Pete and Commissioner Hutchings silent on was funding. Number one, helping fund the United Way Community Response Fund. And then as well, supporting the work of the Chamber, the EDC, the VCB, and to come forward with this Thurston Strong website. And it just, there was like no question. It was just like, of course, this is what we need to do. We also realize that we're codependent on each other. We have many residents that work in other jurisdictions or commute back and forth. So we need to help all businesses across the whole region, and the Thurston Strong model that you guys propped up so quickly, I just, you know, can't commend you enough for working together and really modeling that collective impact that we talk about. I'm good.
And this is Michael Cade. Welcome. Thank you for your leadership, both of you. It's wonderful to live in a community that you have engaged leaders, and you're both have been very engaged. So thank you very much. I know from a citizen standpoint, but also a business standpoint, it's nice to have that leadership. So thank you. You've done some phenomenal stand-up, as Mayor Selby just mentioned. The infrastructure between organizations that you've worked with has been very impressive. One of the things that I want to make sure that there's a lot of victories going on in the community. You know, the Thurston Strong is certainly a victory. Some of the work that David and his team is a victory about ensuring that organizations and companies have direct immediate access. The hotline that we stood up is a direct immediate access success. Is there something that you want to talk about that's immediate success story that maybe people don't know about and should hear about? Because we do need to hear that it's tough. It is tough out there. I got to admit it. You know it. You've talked about it. But what are some of the other success stories and kind of good news that we need to keep our minds on and keep moving onward and upward?
I can jump in real quick. You know, I think we're seeing it all the time within our community of our residents and businesses and people just stepping up to the challenge. One of the great successes that we've seen in Lacey and for our region is our Lacey Makerspace. It's obviously been shut down, but we have several 3D printers there. And then we have people who've been engaged with the Lacey Makerspace. And that network has been producing personal protective equipment, face masks, or the plastic, you know, longer protective masks, to essential workers in need of the equipment. And there's been a huge shortage when it comes to PPE, as you know, a lot of us have heard in the news. And so there are, you know, individuals within our community that happen to have one 3D printer that can print three of those masks off in a day. If they run it 24/7, that's what they're doing. And we've delivered well over 100 of those masks. I don't have the exact number in front of me, but that is just a great example of people stepping up and helping our community. They're doing it out that with their own dollars, and it's making a difference. We have a drop-off box for masks at City Hall, and so people from different knitting clubs and are making masks and dropping them off. And you know, we've also seen stories like the Safeway out near Yelm Highway, next to pretty close to a Bonaventure, which is a retirement assisted living facility. They basically adopted that facility and are doing all the grocery shopping for the residents that live there because they cannot get out. And so we've seen these stories prop up, and it really makes you very proud of our community and of people in general. We have some of the best people in the world right here, and it shows. And I've noticed it, and it really makes all this hard work that we're having to do right now just worth it, because there's such great people. And that's why, you know, we do what we do.
Thank you.
All right. So, yeah, this is what gets me excited, Michael. I'm glad you asked this question, because like, we do need to keep in mind just how amazing our communities are. And so, like I mentioned really quickly earlier, the United Way Fund that was propped up right away, and that helps with some short-term rent assistance and other short-term needs for our community. Those are grants. Across social services, our senior services, the Meals on Wheels program was immediately hit. Mm-hmm. Not only were there volunteers, usually in a high-risk group of seniors, so they needed new volunteers, but they also needed to expand their operations greatly, because there's a lot of the meals weren't being able to be served at the centers anymore, so they all had to be delivered. That's underway. The coordination with the Thurston County Food Bank, across the Lacey Food Bank, the downtown, and then the Mottman facility, they've been expanding leaps and bounds every week with the help of this community's generosity of time and treasure. Locally, there's a Facebook page called the Olympia Mutual Aid Collective, which is a kind of an inventory of assets that people have that they have to share, that's been highly successful. And out of that, there was a whole nother group that started, you know, that were sewing face masks for first responders or people that, not first responders, but folks that are out doing outreach work in our camps and others that are doing food service at Salvation Army and Union Gospel Mission. The Olympia Downtown Association has been working nimbly to prop up a takeout program for restaurants downtown that want to still provide food for people in-house at the city. We had moved our permitting functions online already, so it was a really easy switch to, well, we didn't really lose any ground on our permitting, so that's been a good win for us. We started town hall meetings every week. We've completed three. We have one more next week, but we'll be adding on to those as ways to do outreach to our communities. We deferred utility payments for people that that could not afford to pay their water, sewer, garbage. And then we also deferred our B&O collections until, I think, like end of July. Don't quote me, but I know we deferred them for anyhow. So those are the kind of things, the lighter, quicker, cheaper things that we were able to do to get, you know, quick wins and show our community that we're listening.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, you know, another thing that I thought was really amazing from some of our staff at the City of Lacey is our public affairs people were able to track down the business license of every restaurant in the city of Lacey, and we're called each restaurant to see if they're open, to see if they're doing curbside delivery, if they're or delivery or takeout, and compose a list of every single restaurant and put it on our website so people have access to that. And that was just sort of stepping up and really helping out an industry that's really been hurt in our community. And so I think that's just another great example of the great things that are happening in local government right now.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you very much. These are good stories. And I personally think it's important for us to not necessarily gloss over the tough times, because we do need to certainly pay attention. I like your comment, Mayor Selby, about resiliency and moving forward. But it is important to remember there are some victories out there and those that we build on. So thank you. David, you want to talk a little bit about emergency powers and kind of talk a little bit about that?
So thanks, Michael. Mayor Selby, you and I had a conversation. It might have been 2 weeks, probably 3 weeks ago, where the conversation went something like, as elected officials, we're used to assessing challenges, putting a game plan in place, and then developing partnerships and resources to address the challenge or the problem. But with COVID-19, it's kind of put that mode of operandi on the sideline for especially local elected officials. But there are some things and tools. Obviously, there's the declaration of state of emergency, which the cities and county and our community have done. And then also there might be other unique powers that you as mayor or the cities as municipalities have to help support the community. Did you want to just maybe touch briefly on what those are and what you might be looking to do?
So I think it was actually 5 weeks ago, David.
Oh my goodness.
I know. Time has warped for all of us. It's hard to keep track of the days. So I think what I did is I called you right before we declared our state of emergency and said, we're going to need your help. We're going to need the county. We're going to need all the local governments working together to plan a recovery that we never imagined. And so I think that was kind of where the seeds were planted about who should be around that table. And out of that came Thurston Strong. And I don't know whether I'm answering your question quite right.
So I keep forgetting to unmute the mute button. But I wanted you to maybe just reflect, there are unique policing powers or emergency powers that municipalities have. And I just wanted to provide an opportunity if there's some reflections or if there is elements you'd like to share with people about what leverage points might be with those powers.
Okay, so emergency powers really in my council manager form of government rest with the city manager, in this case, Jay Burney, with council support. So like one of the first things he did was shut all of our municipal buildings down. He shut our play equipment down, which was highly hurtful for a lot of people, but they're adjusting, closed our parking lots in our parks. And those are the kind of things that those emergency based on a highly contagious pandemic scenario that he had to do, where it's going to get interesting is once the governor starts, easing restrictions on social distancing and businesses reopening, where we land in that's where the work is going to be next.
Yeah, I can speak to this a little bit as well. We signed a declaration. I signed the declaration real early on as well. And really what that does is it allows you to streamline any decisions when it comes to funding. For example, there's usually a process in place when you have to purchase something or provide something for the community. With emergency powers, you don't have to necessarily go through that process. You can get funds out quickly where they're needed. It also allows you to apply for hopefully funding to be reimbursed either from the states or from the federal government. And that's what we're really hoping is going to happen next, is that our budgets have been, as you can imagine, have been really been hit hard. Where City of Lacey is in a little different circumstance than Olympia. Olympia has the Autumn Mall and the West Side and Westfield Mall, and those are huge sources of sales tax revenue. We are made up of more of a, we don't have those large centers like that. And so we're not expecting to be hit quite as hard, but we've obviously have pushed off our property taxes. Our Jeff Gadman, our Thurston County Treasurer, has moved that a month back, and we're have also delayed our B&O tax payments for the City of Lacey. And so all that means is, at a time where expenses are way up, right? We're still paying our staff, and we're still having to provide services, and we have very little revenue coming in at all. And that's why, if you look at some of the key sectors in our community, travel being one of them, it is really scary. Our hospitality industry is down like 90% of what they normally would be. And it's going to be a while for them to recover. And so, and of course, we are dependent upon, full occupancy in our hotels to help pay for our LTAC events, in which, so all the big events that we have in this community, a lot of them are sponsored by LTAC funds. And we're taking a look at that right now, including the Regional Athletic Complex, which has been completely shut down. And we're looking at, we're probably not going to have a major event probably throughout this summer and until maybe next year. And so that could be, the 3rd of July fireworks, for example, that's been a part of Lacey for as long as I can remember, is probably not going to happen this year for the first time. And so that is going to be really, as the summer goes along and during the times where we normally have these big events and we're not going to have them probably this year, that's going to take a lot to get adjusted to. And so there's not only an economic impact, but there's a huge impact for our community as well. These events that bring our communities together, that's not going to happen. That's something that we're all going to have to figure out together.
So, Mayors, we have a couple more minutes before we have to shift gears. Is there anything you'd like to wrap up with at this point?
Well, I guess I'll lead off Andy on that one. So where Olympia is, I lost my train of thought. I'm reading people's chat comments. I shouldn't be doing that. One of the things that I think is going to need to happen, and I talked to Andy and the other, I think it was Pete and Commissioner Hutch, about last week, was having a regional conversation when we get through this immediate crisis. This is like this unprecedented big pause that we've been put through. And so we can use it as an opportunity to decide what really is meaningful to us as we rebuild our communities. And I think that has to happen at a regional level. So I actually look forward to that and, being really, mindful of what a healthy, sustainable, and resilient community looks like in the post-COVID era. And each community has their own conversations that they're going to need to have too. But, just discussions around what city operations are going to look like going forward? You know, are we going to do more telecommuting? Are we going to need a more robust local food network than we had before? And I'm kind of excited about having those conversations. So that's my lead, or my ending with a hopeful message, is that things happen for a reason, and we need to find the reason in the madness right now. And I think a lot of that is going to come forward from our community members as we rebuild.
Thank you both. Really appreciate you taking the time to be here today and providing thoughts. We'll definitely, in the next several weeks, have you back, along with some of your other colleagues from other municipalities in the county. Feel free to stay on for the update from our Employment Security Department people, and thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayors.
So the second part, we're excited to have an update from Employment Security. We have Mary Pat Muley, Kevin Dinnan, and Denise Craig. And a lot's been happening, obviously, is an understatement, within Employment Security, both just in the sheer volume, but also the role that the federal government has played with the addition of resources. So with that, I will leave it to the three of you to decide where you want to kick off. And then, of course, I'm sure we'll have some Q&A as well.
Okay, sounds good. I'll go ahead and get started. And it's hard to judge necessarily how much information is already out there and how much of this is a review, but it's still good information. So what I'll do is give you an idea of what has happened recently, in particular in the last week, that is having quite an impact on quite a few people. Really what it relates to is the CARES Act that was signed March 27th, essentially established three separate entitlements related to unemployment insurance benefits that are federally funded. We were able to actually get that stood up and launched it on Sunday. So what I'll do is give you an idea of what the three differences are, because it can be confusing. I'll readily admit that. The first one that I'll mention is called the Federal Pandemic Unemployment Compensation. And really what that does is it provides an additional $600 per week on top of the weekly benefit amount. And this is for anyone who is eligible for at least $1 worth of benefits. And why that's important is because there are a lot of people that still are working reduced hours or part-time when they were working full-time. And when they're reporting their earnings and hours each week, if they're at least eligible after that deduction of $1 worth of benefit, they would get that additional $600. The people who are eligible for this are people who are receiving regular unemployment insurance. And then also the two additional entitlements that I'll mention in just a minute here. Essentially what that does is it gives benefits for the week ending April 4th through July 25th of 2020. When an individual does file that weekly claim, they're determined to be eligible. And they're eligible for that $1 of benefits. They would get that $600 automatically added on to their weekly benefit amount. And it pays at the same time. There's not two separate streams of money going out. It's all added into one payment that goes out. There are no earnings deductions for that $600, though, so that's a little bit different than our regular unemployment benefits. That's just a straight $600 that goes out to individuals that, like I said, meet that criteria of being eligible for benefits of at least $1 per week. The second is the Pandemic Emergency Unemployment Compensation. And what that is, it's essentially an extension of regular unemployment benefits up to 13 additional weeks. And this is for people who have exhausted their regular benefits either by running out of money or time. What I mean by that is if they've drawn all of the money that was available to them on their regular benefits, or if their claim, which is the benefit year end date, which is basically once you establish a claim, it's established for 52 weeks. If they've gone over that 52 week period and they're not eligible for a new claim, they would be eligible for this extension. It's for people who are a key factor is that they're able and available for work and they're unemployed through no fault of their own. And it extends out through beginning actually the week ending April 4th through December 6th of 2020. And so that is, that's for individuals who have, it's essentially just an extension like we had back in the Great Recession where we had individuals on extensions. The third program is the Pandemic Unemployment Assistance, and that is the one that is completely new to everyone. It's a very unique program, and essentially what it is it provides up to 39 weeks of benefits minus any weeks of regular UI and extended benefits the claimant receives. It's a separate benefit program that covers many people who typically don't qualify for regular unemployment insurance. And so it's there is a criteria that is has been established based upon the federal rules that were written around the CARES Act. And essentially it's for people who have exhausted their entitlements to regular UI or that pandemic emergency unemployment compensation as well. It's for people who self-certify that they are available for work and unemployed or underemployed for a handful of reasons. There's quite a few. I'll just run through them real quick. And so it's available for work and unemployed or underemployed for one of the reasons, or they're unavailable to work because they have a COVID-19 diagnosis, experiencing symptoms of COVID-19 and are seeking a medical diagnosis, have a household member who's been diagnosed with COVID-19, are the primary caregiver for a family member or household member who has been diagnosed with COVID-19. They have a child or other household member who is out of school, daycare, or other facility due to closure. They can't get to work because of quarantine. They've been advised to self-quarantine. They were scheduled to start a job and do not have a job or aren't able to reach the job. They've become the breadwinner or major support for a household because the head of household died as a result of COVID-19. They had to quit as a direct result of COVID-19. So then their place of employment closed. So typically what we're looking at is the groups that will qualify are individuals who didn't have the 680 hours that's required to usually qualify for regular benefits, self-employed individuals, independent contractors, corporate officers, business owners, and then also those employees who work in the gig economy, where we have, where it's been determined that their employment's not covered employment that would fall under regular unemployment benefits. It also covers people who are just seeking part-time work only. That is probably the one that has drawn the most interest as of late because it is new. There is an application process what has to happen is there has to be a claim for regular unemployment benefits that demonstrates an individual isn't eligible for regular unemployment benefits. And the way the system is set up is that you can go on to e-services, electronic services, and sign up for a Secure Access Washington account. And you can go in and go through the process. If you are, it's intuitive in nature. So if you file an unemployment claim and you do not have the 680 hours, it will then prompt you to go ahead and apply for the pandemic unemployment assistance. And then that's a series of questions that you have to answer. It also requires, and this is unique, it requires that you provide wage information. And typically what an example of the type of acceptable documents that we would use for verification of earnings would be an IRS form Schedule C or K, SE or F. If you go to our website, there is additional information about the application process and what's expected. I can tell you that the way that the system is set up is that it will be benefits amounts will be determined based upon the wages that are reported by an individual when they do go in and they apply. The expectation or rule is that that we have to then verify that through documentation you support, and that's why I mentioned the IRS forms. And when we have dedicated a significant amount of resources to be doing those reviews and verifying those wages on a regular basis. When you do apply for the pandemic unemployment assistance, it gives you an opportunity to provide us with the documentation right away. If you don't have that right away, then you are able to go back in after the fact and provide it to us. And the expectation is you do it within 21 days in order to meet the eligibility requirements. What's unique about pandemic unemployment assistance is that it does expand coverage to a significant amount of people. We have already admit that we did run into some challenges with bandwidth. And part of that, well, the major reason behind that is the number of people that were accessing our system. We have been working diligently to expand that bandwidth and anticipate that we will have up to 900,000 people filing claims this upcoming week. And knowing that, we are working diligently to boost our capacity to be able to have people on our systems. I'd imagine in past presentations where I've been involved, there's been questions. So I guess we'll open it up to questions.
Yeah, you bet. So there's several questions. One of the questions has to do with getting into the system and getting past the login. Could you share a little bit about system in general, both the volume and the plan of action that you're working on to try to ensure that there is, as best as possible, timely addressing of people's applications?
I will readily admit I'm not a tech expert. I can understand what they're saying, but I can't translate it into something that's digestible. But what I can tell you is that in the past number of weeks, we have made significant improvements in terms of people's access and ability to get into the Secure Access Washington and then actually into our website to establish e-services, an e-services account, and then be able to file their initial claim, apply for the additional potential benefits that they're eligible for, in addition to filing their weekly claims. In terms of the increase in capacity, I know that it is one of the primary points of focus for the commissioner and our IT department. They are partnering with other state agencies as well as our partner at the WATEC to ensure that we have bandwidth, as much bandwidth as possible to handle the traffic. It is an unprecedented amount of traffic that we saw and that we continue to see, both on our website and then also just in general in terms of, to give you a sense of the impact just in 1 week that these new programs have had, is that I believe just this week alone, we issued almost $900 million in benefits, nearly $900 million just this week out of Washington for unemployment benefits. So that is, that's indicative of the number of people that are applying and receiving these new benefits. I wish I could give you more detail about the IT side of things, other than just knowing that we're committed to, working as hard as we can and that this is a primary focus to increase access.
Great. I'm going to just read this question.
Okay.
It's a little hard to paraphrase. For pandemic UI of self-unemployed, do they need to file claims for the week ending 4-4 and 4-11, or will their initial claims cover those time periods? If they need to file for that prior weeks, for those prior weeks, how do they do this?
Yeah, so what'll happen is, what they need to do, and I know that there might have been some mixed messages that were shared and potentially even with these meetings about going on and applying. And that was at that time that the information we had is that would be the best thing to do. It's not as though it created any problems, but what we'll need individuals to do is go back in and go through the process again. And in doing that process, you'll be able to file the initial claims because it is allowing backdating. I neglected to mention that the pandemic unemployment assistance actually reaches back quite a bit farther than the other two, and it goes to the weeks ending February 8th through December 26th, 2020. And the questions that you're asked when you're applying for that pandemic unemployment assistance in terms of the timing of when you were impacted by COVID-19 in one way, shape, or form will drive when that benefit becomes available to you, and then you can file those weekly claims at that time going through that process.
So someone asked the question, what does $900 million essentially compare to during normal workloads for unemployment or payouts for unemployment?
I don't have that readily in front of me. We can get that. And it might be in the press conference information that is sent out on a weekly basis. What I can give you some perspective on in terms of just even before the pandemic unemployment assistance, usually in most weeks we would file initial claims in the range of 5,000 to 7,000 initial claims per week. And once the stay home, stay safe order was put in place, within a couple of weeks of that, we were up to filing 180 plus thousand initial claims per week. So just to give you a little perspective on the number of people that are impacted by this, we typically don't see traffic like that. And it wasn't just a one-week scenario. We continue to see high volumes of initial claims filed, and now we're seeing also the volume. And it points to the fact that we are preparing for as many as 900,000 weekly claim filers starting this Sunday. That's unheard of.
So there was a question earlier. I thought this may be more on the policy end, and maybe too early. But as far as unemployment rates for businesses in the state of Washington due to the COVID, has the state had any conversations yet as far as how they will address that?
Denise, I don't know if you have any insight that you could help out with.
So we are working on some things right now. One of the questions was if they had been impacted by COVID or COVID-19, could they get, you know, relief for their tax rate, and they just need to apply for relief of benefit charges for the employees who are impacted by that, and then they would get relief granted and that would not impact their rate. It is my understanding for those employers who have applied for and have been approved for shared work, that they are not, that will not also impact their tax rate for employees who are receiving funds from the CARES Act. For reimbursable employers or that actually don't have a tax rate, it is my understanding that currently, as it stands, and I don't know if there's going to be any changes, if there's going to be any new rulemaking, but that the federal government will reimburse for 50% of the benefit charges that are incurred by reimbursable employers. And so they pay dollar for dollar. So they don't have a tax rate, but a lot of them are being impacted because they don't normally have as many claims as they currently have. And so that is what they're doing for reimbursable employers. I have reached out to ask if we're going to do any additional emergency rulemaking around tax rates and relief of benefit charges. And I'm still waiting to hear back what additional things will be done. They are working on some things, but I don't think either it hasn't, the emergency rule hasn't passed yet and it's still in the works. And so I don't feel comfortable talking about that until everything has passed. Does that kind of answer the question? Or do I need to clarify anything?
I think there's several answers within there. Thank you. So here's a question that's work versus not work. The question revolves around receiving the PPP funding and to keep employees employed, and employees deciding that they rather try to pursue unemployment benefits because they are more robust at the moment compared to what they once were. Any thoughts or generalities? I don't want to get too down into the weeds on that type of question, but I think it is a fair question for an employer to be asking.
Yeah, I think it's a very fair question and the agency also is keenly aware of the potential for this. What I would suggest is you can go in to as an employer and report that to us through e-services. That would be probably the best way to do it right now because we're being flooded with paperwork. We are working on ensuring that we are identifying those instances where that is happening. I'll let you know that there are many conversations going on about that. I was involved in multiple conversations this week about it. And now we manage that workload because that's going to be unique because we have to potentially look at assessing fraud in some situations. So yes, it is, we're very aware of it. It's at the forefront of our mind as well. And we're working on ensuring on our end that when that is reported to us, that we are doing the due diligence that's necessary to investigate that.
Great. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I think we are really getting close to our deadline here. Is there other information or other things? We do have several questions that are two parts, or I think what we'd like to do is maybe shoot some of those to you.
Sure.
Maybe if you could address them directly would be most helpful. There's a few of them there, and I think that might be the quickest way to get a really good answer that's very attentive to these individuals' questions. With that, though, I want to thank Kevin, Denise, and Mary Pat for your time today. Is there anything else that any of you would like to share or anything else we need to be aware of about ESD?
I would just like to thank everyone for your patience. I heard Cheryl and Andy mentioning about never dreaming that this would be something that they would have to face, and that's not unique to just them. I think it's everyone that is in that position, both on a personal level, but also from a work perspective and from our agency's perspective. I don't know who could have ever been prepared for the severity and the scope of the challenges that we're facing right now. And so we are doing the best that we can just to hire as many employees as we can so that we can provide better access. We are looking at ways to ensure that we are doing our due diligence about paying people appropriately, because I think there's sometimes a misunderstanding that unemployment is just a one-step process where you apply for benefits and it's determined that you have the monetary eligibility, meaning that you have the 680 hours and wages that were paid. But there's multiple other factors that go into determining eligibility, and we are making sure that we are doing our best to balance out the need for individuals to get paid, as well as meeting our requirements as an agency to make sure that we are addressing eligibility properly. So it's challenging, it's complicated, and I just appreciate everyone's patience.
Well, thank you for the attentiveness to be here this afternoon. ESD has done a remarkable job of making themselves available for the conversations for people that need information. So very much appreciate that of all of you, and of course the organization as a whole. Thank you to our mayors, Mayor Selby, Mayor Ryder, for your conversation and the efforts that you are doing in our community, both for your municipalities and, of course, as a regional leaders. And think, Mike, Michael, you want to chime in on, we always like to end on some resources. You want to chime in on some resources?
Yeah. Thank you, David. And truly thank you to representatives from Employment Security. Thank you for your good work. I know these are tough times, but personal note, thank you. I just want to remind people about the hotline that we have for business hotline. Some of the questions that we're scrolling through, I wouldn't hesitate to give our hotline a call and ask the questions for direction and resources and reference. Just to remind people, it's 1-888-821-6652. So it's 821-6652. And then the other thing that happened today was Commerce just announced this afternoon that they're working Washington emergency small business grant that we've been asked to manage or collect resources or collect applications for them. They did refund that, essentially put another $5 million into that statewide. So I know that's not a lot of dough when you consider there was 28,000 applications statewide. So I just want to let people know that the process that we're undertaking is to use the 900 applications that were already submitted and expand that review towards those as well. So I want to make sure that people knew that. We're also, as a lot of you know out there, we run a fairly successful and aggressive business tune-up program. We've pivoted that towards build your market with COVID-19. So that class will be starting on May 22nd. Please register or find out information on our Thurston EDC website.